Lord God, in the name of Jesus, we ask that you would guide our hearts and our minds. We ask that your word would come forth. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we ask that your spirit will dwell among us. Oh God, in the mighty name of Jesus, we give you the praise. We give you the honor. We give you the glory for all things that you have done for us. Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus that you continue opening doors, that you make a way for us, that you will bind the hand of the enemy, oh God, in the mighty name of Jesus, and that you rebuke him now, oh God. For God, we do thank you now. We give you all the glory, the honor, the praise, in the mighty name of Jesus. We say thank you, Jesus, for all you have done for us. And all the people said, amen.
Amen.
Turn with me to the book of Acts. The book of Acts. And the 17th chapter of the book of Acts, and starting at verse 1. The 17th chapter of the book of Acts, starting at verse 1. And herein and therein you will find these words. Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and three Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus whom I preach unto you is Christ. And some of them believed and consorted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks a great multitude, and of the chief women not a few. But the Jews, which believed not, moved with envy, took unto them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort, and gathered a company, and set all the city in an uproar, and assaulted the house of Jason, and sought to bring them out of the people. And when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brothers unto the rulers of the city, crying, "These that have turned the world upside down are come hither also, whom Jason hath received, and these all do contrary to the decree of Caesar, saying that there is no other king one Jesus." And when they troubled the people and the rulers of the city when they heard these things. And when they had taken security of Jason and of the other, they let them go. Those who have an ear, let them hear what the Spirit of the Lord has to say. Verse 5, but the Jews which believed not, moved with envy, took unto them a certain lewd fellow and the baser sort, and gathered a company, and set a city in an uproar, and assaulted the house of Jason, and sought to bring them out of the people. In the light of the current event, dealing with the Ferguson, Missouri situation, our subject matter today is Thessalonica unrest. Thessalonica unrest. Whereas with the current events in Ferguson, that the unrest in Ferguson is that people look for justice for one who was killed by the authority of the police officer. The unrest in Ferguson, the protest that is going on, looking for justice, and no justice, no peace. The injustice that was done to Michael Brown. But here in this text, we have a similar kind of situation. But the situation here, as in Thessalonica, is that the unrest, as you will, in Thessalonica, was that it came to pass or came to be in existence because that some Jews has a problem with Paul and Silas preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Whereas in Thessalonica, the unrest come from the truth of the matter of the gospel of Jesus Christ. But then we have there in Ferguson that the unrest was the injustice of a teenager being killed. But I think I need to share notice with you this morning is that if we have more people, if you will, to spread the gospel as they are protesting in Ferguson, there'd be less likely of a livelihood. There will be more of a great injustice that is done. So, but here the Apostle Paul and Silas are in Athens, and Athens, which is in Greece, and Thessalonica, which is a part of Athens. Now that you have that upon this journey of the Apostle Paul, that they had went through a couple of cities, and now they had come through Thessalonica, which is a city of Greece. But there in Thessalonica, there was some synagogues that was already established for the Jews to come and worship or come to hear a word or of their practice, their Judaism. But then when the Apostle Paul arrived in Athens and ultimately going to Thessalonica, he entered as he usually would do, go to the synagogue to where the Jews were. Now, when the Apostle Paul went to the synagogue in Thessalonica, he didn't go there without having a purpose. And I think it is safe to say that we have so many people nowadays, they may come to the church house, but they do not come there for any real purpose. A lot of people, they just come there to socialize. They just come there really because it was something they would do on a regular basis or once a week. How many, we need more people who come to church to have a purpose. And when we come to the Lord's house, we should come with a purpose. And that purpose should be, in a sense, that one, that we should come and to render the praise and worship the Lord. And then secondly, that when we come to the Lord's house, that we will come to fellowship and to encourage one and another. Oftentimes when people come to the Lord's house, or when they come to church on Sunday mornings, they come without a purpose, and the only sole purpose, if they have a purpose, will be to come and see the friends who they have not seen for a whole week, rather than have the church house to be a meeting place. It has become a place of meetings to where people will come to socialize rather than to come and worship and praise the Lord. You see, the Apostle Paul, he went to the synagogue as he usually was, but he went there to present Jesus Christ as being the Messiah and or being the Savior of the world. You see, if you remember in Romans 10 that the Apostle Paul starts out saying that my heart's desire and prayer for Israel is that they might be, that they might be saved. So then the Apostle Paul, as he was going into the synagogue, then he was going there to present Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I think that it is safe to say that nowadays, how many of us or how many people will go to the Lord's house nowadays and really hear something about Jesus? You see, the Apostle Paul, he went there because that the Jews, they have not yet acknowledged that Jesus has been the Son of of God. He has not acknowledged, they have not acknowledged that Jesus has been the Messiah of the world. So he went to the synagogue to introduce or argue to the point that to introduce Christ to the church. And you know, it seems like that, you know, everywhere we go, that we should have a ready answer for those who do not know Jesus for themselves. We should be able to tell somebody about Jesus. You know, the sad commentary here is that the Apostle Paul, he went into the synagogue, he went into the church to introduce Jesus. And it just seemed to me that since the Jews or the Pharisees or the scribes or the Sadducees, since they were so much into the word, it just would appear to me is that they would have known who Jesus really was. And I think that it is safe to say that because a person knows the Bible, that does not mean they know the Lord. Just because a person knows the scriptures from Genesis to Revelation does not mean they know Jesus. And how many of us know that there are some people who come to church Sunday after Sunday and still don't know the Lord? And the way things are going nowadays is that Jesus is being left out of the worship experience. And rather than people worshiping and praising God for what he has already done for them in their lives, people nowadays, they are worshiping the Lord or praising God to see what they can get from him. But I think I need to share notice with you is that God has given his very best to us when he gave his only begotten son to die for us. So in essence, that God, he doesn't owe us anything, but we owe him everything. How many of us know that we owe God everything? And so many times that people, they come to the Lord's house, they come there haphazardly because it is something, it appears to be the right thing to do rather than to give God the praise. Now look what the Apostle Paul did. The Bible says that he went into the synagogue three Sabbaths. For once a week, three Sabbaths, as he normally does, to argue or to point up and introduce who Jesus really was. And what the Apostle Paul did, he did not just only argue to the point that Jesus is the Messiah of the world or that Jesus is the Savior of the world, but he went there in the scriptures to back up his claim that who Jesus was. Now, I observed that in the Apostle Paul time that they did not have the New Testament, but they had the Old Testament. So he had the Old Testament to back up his claim that Jesus was the Messiah of the world. And I think I need to share notice with you that every child of God, that if you are or if we are going to defend who Jesus really is, we should not only have our word, but we should all always have the word to back up what Jesus is, who Jesus is, who we say he is. We need to know the word of God. If you don't, you ought to carry the Bible with you. If you don't want to carry a physical Bible, you at least nowadays ought to have it on your tablet or on your phone. So when you're ready, when you need it, then you can pull it right on up. And that's not to say that you will know the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, but you ought to have some scripture in your heart to back up that you are saved. You ought to have some scripture to back up that you know who Jesus really is. And that if no more, then you ought to know Psalm 23 and verse 1, and that is, the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. And then if there is no other scripture, then you ought to know John 3:16, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, and that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So the Apostle Paul, he had scriptures. He made references to the scriptures, to the Old Testament, to present Jesus in the church. And that is a sad commentary to where you have to go to church to introduce Jesus to to the leaders. And I think that it is, safe to say we have so many people who quote Hosea 4 and 6 to where he said that my people perish for the lack of knowledge. You see, the key thing is that when you finish reading that scripture, when he said my people perish for the lack of knowledge, God turned around. He was talking to the priest of that time because he said that you reject knowledge. In essence, he is saying that the leaders in the church of that time was not studying or believing the word of God, and therefore the people are perishing because the leaders did not know who God was. Is there a lot, like a lot of this that's going on nowadays, that we have so many people who are in the church, so many leaders who are in the church, but they do not know Jesus. Now, we have a lot of people who say they are pastoring, but they do not know Jesus, and they do not study the word of God. So therefore, because they are lacking, the congregation is lacking. Now, church is more than, and it should not be about rap songs or the latest rap leader, but it should be about Jesus Christ and him crucified, and it should be about what Jesus has already done for us, and we need to revamp our thinking when we come to the Lord's house, to where we will come to experience the presence of the Lord, and not just in an emotional, ecstatic response. You see, when you have a made up mind that you're going to go to the Lord's house and you're going to empty yourself, you're going to give all yourself to him, then you can experience the presence of the Lord. So then the Apostle Paul is going into the synagogue, and he is defending and preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ to even the Pharisees and the scribes in the church. And I think I need to share, to share Jesus Christ in the church. So then when the Apostle Paul had talked about Jesus in the synagogue, then there were some people there who believed that Jesus Christ was the Savior of the world. And I think I need to share notice that there Jesus had a lot of problems out of the Jews, but every Jew was not risen against Jesus Christ and the Apostle Paul, because there were some Jews who believed that Jesus was the Messiah or Savior of the world. Now, because the Apostle Paul was preaching the gospel, because of the Apostle Paul and Silas was preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, it started to move out all of the city. And so the prominent people in Athens, or in Athens, Greece, started believing in Jesus Christ. Now, I think I need to share a notice with him. Any place that where Jesus is preached, it started to take over that community. Any place where Jesus Christ is preached, it started to take over that nation. Why do you think that the Christianity is so much under attack now these days? Because it starts to move, when God starts to move in a nation, when the gospel is preached in a nation, when the gospel is preached in a city, it starts to move like it had like never before, and it starts to move and take over. You see, now so many of the other religions are having a problem with Jesus Christ because he is starting to move and take over a lot of these cities and these nations. How many of us know that wherever God is, that there is liberty? Wherever Christ is, that you are set free, and you are free indeed. You know, so that where the unrest come in at Thessalonica is, that these men, Paul and Silas, start preaching the gospel, and the Jews didn't like what they was hearing. So now what the Jews did, if you will, they went and got some rude and some bad men to bring about uproar and unrest in Thessalonica. And you know, it is easy to find somebody to do the wrong thing, but it's not so easy to find someone to do the right thing. So the Jews, they found these mean men to go throughout the city to cause an uproar, to start looting, to start protesting, to start bringing about all kind of problems in the city of Thessalonica, because they didn't like the fact that Jesus Christ was being preached in that city. So they got word that Paul and Silas was in Jason's house. So what they did, they started picketing around Jason's house and started looking for Paul and Silas, and found out they was not there. So what they did, they took and drug Jason and the other people that was in the house and drug them down to the city hall, and then started press charges on Jason and the other people who were in their house. And you know, Jason didn't know where Paul and Silas were. And I think I need to share notice with you. Just as Jason was drug out of his home because of Paul and Silas preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, how many of us is going to take a stand for when the law and the police officers want to come to your house and want to take the Bible out of your house? Who gonna take a stand when the people of authority want to accuse you of believing in Jesus Christ? You know that Paul and Silas, they went about preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ until the Jews said that they had turned this city or this world upside down. I think that if we want to turn the city upside down, then we ought to bring about Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Now we have so many clergymen, if you will, who know resist the marching down in Ferguson. Now, I would have to commend Pastor Tracy Blackman, who was the leader down in the protesting. She is the pastor of Christ the King, United Church of Christ, who have taken a lead down in the protest. Now, my question is, now you have all of these African-American men pastors in the city who are prominent in this city. They are nowhere around, but I think I need to share notice with you that ministry goes beyond the walls of the church. Sometimes you have to have some righteous indignation, and that means in the world sense that you have to have some civil unrest and take a stand. You see, there are so many pastors who don't want to pay the cost to stand for something that isn't right. You know, when you're going to be a true leader, then there is a cost that you have to pay. How many of us know that being a leader, there is a cost you have to pay? But I think I need to share notice with you that when the cost is for the Lord, that He will restore back to you whatever you have given up. How many of us know that there is a cost to be a disciple? You know now that the Apostle Paul and Jason, the Apostle Paul and Silas, gospel of Jesus Christ. And these men set the city on the world. They turned the world upside down. Now I think I need to share notice with them. If we want to turn the world upside down, if we want to turn the community upside down, we need to preach more Jesus. We need to preach more love. We need to preach more Holy Ghost around these cities. How many of us know that whenever Jesus is in the picture, he tends to turn things all the way around? You know that when Jesus came on the scene, that the people, the Jews, had a problem with the teachings of Jesus because it was different from what they are normally hearing. When Jesus had talked with authority, the people followed wherever he had went. And I was with the Apostle Paul until when Jason and the others was in the household. I had to go down and be locked behind bars because of the teaching and preaching of Jesus Christ. Is there anybody here? Is there anybody there who is willing to go to jail for Jesus? After all, Jesus, when you were lost in your sins, that he died on that cross, that he died while we were still enemies from God, that he died on one Friday, but early that Sunday morning, he got out of that grave with all power in his hand. You know, and since the when Jason and the others had posted upon that they had let them go, and I think I need to share notice that if there is any unrest in our communities, it ought to be that you're preaching Jesus Christ and him crucified. And if you are protesting, you ought to walk the street and let somebody know that Jesus, he is alive. And I run down, is there anybody here who knows that Jesus is alive? Is there anybody here who knows that Jesus will make it all right? Is there anybody here who knows that Jesus is the Son of God? Is it living on the valley? Is it bright morning star? And two hearts are pouring in the valley. Ezekiel wheel in the middle of a wheel. Is it bright morning star? Is there anybody here who knows that Jesus will turn around? Is it all right? Is it all right? If you know that he is all right, let me hear you say yes. Yes. Unrest in Thessalonica because Paul and Silas were preaching the gospel, and that the gospel of Jesus Christ was turning the world upside down. And I know there's a lot going on in Ferguson, Missouri, as protests. But if we really want to make a difference and turn the world upside down, stop talking more about Jesus.
Amen.
Let the pastors start coming together. If the pastors would come together and preach more Jesus Christ, probably less evil going on in our community. We're going to extend the invitation